Dr. Colin Gonzalez is a senior advocate, Supreme Court of India, and the founder of Human Rights Law Network. He is a graduate from IIT Bombay. He has his professional life as a civil engineer, but was drawn into the field of law through his work with the unions in India. He commenced formal law studies in 1979 and litigated his first case while still in law school. His most significant victories in the courtroom include the 2001 right to food case. His other prominent cases include the reinstatement of a teacher having cerebral palsy, stays on the demolition of slums, reduction in the prices of essential medicines, and so on. He was presented with the International Human Rights Award by the American Bar Association in 2005. He was also given the Mother Teresa Memorial Award for Social Justice in recognition of remarkable contribution in legal services addressing human rights in 2010. Most recently, in September 2017, he was awarded the prestigious Right Livelihood Award for his tireless and innovative use of public interest litigation. We welcome him to our college.
Thank you very much. We have about an hour from 9:30 till about 10:30, 11 perhaps, latest. And I thought instead of giving you a formal lecture, maybe we do a sort of an interactive session on human rights and law. Before I came in, I chatted with your professor for a little while, and I was very pleased to hear that the fees in Government Law College are 8,000 rupees a year, because as you know, fees are skyrocketing in this country, and the national law universities that were set up, originally the National Law University in Bangalore, I remember Professor Madhava Menon, the director, waxing eloquent on how these universities would be centers for public interest litigation and public law. And today the National Law Universities are centers for corporate law. And their fees have skyrocketed to several lakhs a year, isn't it? And I was also very pleased to hear that you have a reservation for women in the Government Law College. You have more than 60% women in the Government Law College. So it's a wonderful field. And I went to the ground floor and I saw your tables and chairs, those old wooden tables and chairs. You know, we may laugh at it, you know, really. But it doesn't really matter whether your tables and chairs are made of old wood or whether it's a fancy. They brought me to this place. They say, this is our fancy, you know, a lecture room as compared to that. I love that room because it really doesn't matter if it's old wood or whatever. It matters what is the atmosphere inside the college, which generates thought, provocative ideas, flowing against the tide, and so on. And I must tell you, in this country, the situation is awful. Professors and teachers in the country are being monitored for what they say. You are living in a very political period. When we went into law, we were in a political period of another kind. Indira Gandhi, emergency, Jai Prakash Narayan movement, the railway strike, George Fernandez giving fiery speeches. In Bombay, they threw the textile workers out of the railway workers, out of their homes at midnight. So all the railway colonies in Bombay, the workers were caught at midnight and their families were thrown out at midnight. And many of the students, including students at IIT, where I was, we went around helping the railway workers to find accommodation and so on. In the middle of the night, they threw them out. Then you had, of course, the textile strike. So it was a virile period, a very political period in which we grew. And because it was a virile environment, your mind begins to tick. You begin to think of things outside the box. You begin to think of things outside your law books. So you try and think of the connection between law and society and so on. So that was a very vibrant period. And if at all I learned some things in that period, it was because of the society pressure on me, the kind of changes and developments taking place in society, which made our minds ferment and think about things. Then it was very quiet for a long time, very, very quiet for a long time, the period of globalization, everybody looking to get good corporate jobs, and all the parents will tell you, get married, take a nice job, why are you getting into human rights, you know? So societal pressure and parental pressure was terrible during this period of globalization. couple. Because it appeared as if globalization was successful. Many people got jobs, you know, selling refrigerators, selling washing machines, doing all kinds of stuff. So it looked as if it was okay. And now again, in our beloved Prime Minister, let me say, we have all kinds of situations developing in this country. I'll indicate some. Because Modi has really taken the political debate to a different level altogether. I'll ask some of you some questions and reactions to what you think. But very important political developments are taking place. Combined with, and this you'll see unfolding in the next few years, combined with the realization that the promises made to the young may not materialize. You were told, right, it's going to be good days, it's going to be fantastic days, you're going to get jobs, you're going to get fancy salaries, everything will be all right, you don't need to think. Don't think. Get your degree, pass out, apply for jobs, you'll be all right. But it's not necessarily going to be that way. And so if you're in your 20s today, you'll want to think ahead. What will it be like when I'm 25, 30, 35, get married, have children? What will my life be like? How do I see myself in society? I've got a law degree. What am I going to do with that law degree? How many of you really want to practice law after getting a law degree? Even after marriage? Yeah? How many of you feel you want to work in human rights? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Not bad, 11, 12. And could any of you put your hands up? Why would you want to work in human rights? What's the reason? Can any of you here?
I think it will have a greater job satisfaction.
Greater job satisfaction, that's completely true. Because when you go to bed at night, every night you realize that you managed to help somebody and you put a smile on the face of your client. And your client was so desperate and had absolutely no chance of, you know, getting the case done because if you didn't have money for paying the lawyer and so on. And you managed to do the case and you got the client happy again. Tremendous satisfaction, I must say personally. For me, it's been tremendous satisfaction all along. And I generally sleep very well at night, even though I don't make as much money as my other fellow senior advocates in the Supreme Court. I don't make as much money. I don't even make half as much money as they make, but I'm very satisfied with the work that we do. And we're able to change the world around us significantly. I'll give you some examples and ideas, but you're able to change the world around you significantly. Can anybody else say why they want to do human rights? Anybody else? Anyone knows who put up their hands?
I think it's the need of the day. We need to fight for the rights of the people who don't know how to do it. We need to help people. If we have a degree in law and we can do something for the society, we need to do it.
Very good. Lovely answer. Lovely answer. And are you ready to do that?
Yes, sir. I want to.
Don't you think it's dangerous?
It might be, but I like it challenging.
Your parents support you?
Yes, they do.
They say, go ahead and do it?
Yes.
They must be proud of you then, isn't it? That you'll do your law, you'll get a law degree, you'll go to court and you'll be a fiery woman lawyer. Wonderful. Wonderful. But you get a lot of skepticism from time to time from people because of society around you. And they, rather than you go for corporate work and all that, but you, I suppose, it's your life. So if you have to go into corporate work, it's not a bad thing per se. And if you have to come, what would be the surest sign that you are cut out to do human rights work? What will be the best indicator? I mean, if you think of yourself and how you think and so on, how would you know that you want to do human rights and I don't want to do something else? How would you know? Can anyone say it? It's a very personal thing.
An urge to take an action against him.
When you can't bear it.
Both answers. Good, yeah? what I call a gut reaction. You tell me?
The ability to empathize with people.
Empathy. Empathy, you can't bear it. And what did you say?
The urge to take an action against injustice.
Correct, the urge. So I call it the gut reaction. Right? Let's say you're walking down this BT station and you see a policeman go up to a beggar who's like sleeping on a bench and at night, and he hits him and says, Hato yasa, hits him. And then many will pass by. And then you feel an anger inside you and say, why is he beating him? That's the second stage. You feel an anger inside you, right? You feel an urge. And then you're a human being. You're alive as a human being because your feelings and empathy, anger, are aroused. And then the next step would be to catch the policeman and say, stop it. Right? But young people now, because you've been hit by globalization for so long, and we have lost the philosophical moorings of social democracy, of socialism, of social change, of the poor rising up in revolt, of society, masses of people coming in movements like the Jai Prakash movement for change in India. We have lost those moorings. So in a sense, our human rights, little sensitivities, all our human rights antennas have become very dull. So now we don't. When we were in college and so on, if we heard something, somebody say something, or we were in a meeting and we heard somebody say something, we wouldn't hesitate. In a second, from the back of the audience, we'd say some very rude things and correct them and fight them. It was a different period then. And I want to say that period is coming back. That period is coming back with a whole range of issues which I want to sort of sound you out to see what kind of reactions we have and what can we do. Now, yesterday, of course, you must have seen four judges of the Supreme Court sitting on the lawn. But I don't want to get too much into that gossip mode about what they did and all that. How many of you feel that those judges actually let down the institution by holding a public meeting? They ought not to have spoken publicly. They should have gone and complained to the president or something. How many feel that they did something right? How many feel it's wrong? How many feel they did something right? Oh, very good. So when I meet some of them, I'll tell them the government law, college students, supported you wholeheartedly. And who feels it's wrong? Anyone feels it was wrong what they did? Anybody? Not particularly. You're going to have very strong feelings about that. So these are very, very important cases. For example, just Judge Lawyer's case where he was killed. He was dealing with a very sensitive case relating to the Chief Justice is the master of the rules. In that sense, you can assign, but when you start assigning matters to a particular bench, politically sensitive matters to a particular bench, it gave rise to a certain degree of disquiet, not only among the lawyers but also among the judges. It gave rise to a feeling that maybe the assignment is not transparent, and maybe the assignment is not fair, and it kept building up and building up and building up. And ultimately, you have the extraordinary development, and I went immediately on record to say that I salute the four judges for what they did. It's an extraordinary act of courage. It's not easy for a judge to say, I'll do a press conference against your Chief Justice, and it maintained the integrity of the judicial system. It was a very powerful step in favor of independence of the judiciary. And who's the principal wrongdoer in all this? It's Government of India. Right? The Government of India is playing a very active role in interfering with judges. Today, and the Chief Minister of Delhi said this in the 50th anniversary of the Delhi High Court, where the Chief Justice, Law Minister, the Prime Minister, everybody was present. And Arvind Kejriwal was bold enough to say that we hear rumors. The judges' telephones are being hacked. And it's very correct. The security departments, the intelligence bureau is tapping the phones of judges. Can you imagine? Perhaps even judges' wives. So, you know, can you imagine the level of executive interference in the judiciary? So they get a little snippet here, they get a little snippet there, then maybe they'll tell the judge, listen, this is what we have on you, and so on. And then the judge has to, you know, remain quiet. He is terrified, or she is terrified because of this. And so, you know, intelligence bureau reports being used against young judges. If you're a fiery young judge, fiery young lawyer, you've done this, you've done that, you've handled some terrorism cases, you've done this, and now you've become a good criminal lawyer, and now you're going to be considered as judgeship. And the intelligence bureau reports will come. Oh, this young man took up this case of this terrorist when he's young. We have doubts about his integrity. Now, many people are very fiery and, you know, outspoken when they are very, very young. It's not necessarily true that they'll be bad judges. So this is what is happening, very, very serious interference with the judiciary by the executive. And that's at the heart of the matter of this protest that is taking place. And you know how the government has actually kept the judiciary with hundreds and hundreds of posts vacant in an attempt really to kill the judiciary, to kill the functioning. And who's the first person who will talk about delays in cases? Government of India. They come on the same dais as the Chief Justice and so on and say, you guys are responsible for delays. Why is your legal process so poor? Why are you granting so many adjournments? What would be the answer to that? Who causes delays? What would be the answer to that? I've already told you the accusation, right? They do it on all platforms when the Chief Justice is present. Oh, your system is rotten, your system needs overhaul. Look at the length, it takes 7 years for a case, 10 years for a case, there are so many pendencies. Change your system, work on Saturdays. I remember Kalam telling the judge, work on Saturdays. Not knowing that a Supreme Court judge, a High Court judge, works every Saturday, every Sunday. You go to a Supreme Court judge's house, let's suppose you have they call you for a meeting. The Supreme Court judge will start working at 8 o'clock in the morning. On Mondays to Fridays, he starts work at 5 o'clock in the morning, reading his papers. And he works every Saturday, Sunday. What is the reason why you have delays? Does anyone know?
Lawyers seeking adjournments.
That's the government story. What's the real story?
Technicalities and procedures.
That's the government story.
Last number of judges.
Correct.
Initial backlog.
Correct. If you have one-fifth the number of judges that you need, and if the government doesn't appoint judges, say a judge can handle 10, 15 cases in a day, finish all 15, no adjournments. But if you have 70 cases, because you have one-fifth the number of judges, so you have five times the number of cases. So instead of 15, you have 75 cases. Judges in the Supreme Court have 75 cases a day. Judges in the lower court, 75 cases a day. So he must adjourn. Maybe 50 cases. He has to adjourn 50 cases. So any excuse he gets, he'll adjourn. It's because he's not supposed to have 75 cases. He's just supposed to have 50 cases. Okay, so now let's get back into some of the juicy issues that have come up before the court. And then I want to end by telling you how powerful a tool the public interest litigation system is. The opportunities available for you in human rights work. What does human rights mean? What are the branches of law for human rights? What are the branches of law that come within the ambit of human rights? When you say human rights, what does it mean? Human rights law means what?
Everything.
Give me some examples. Constitutional law, correct. Labor law, correct.
Tribal rights.
Environment. Who said tribal?
Tribal rights,
correct. Minority rights would play itself out how?
Women and children.
Criminal law. So this is a huge area of law. And often these hoity-toity guys who practice corporate law or intellectual property rights or trademark law, you know, they tell you that they are the mainstream. And you human rights lawyers are the, you know, little tributary on the side. We are the mainstream. But if you look at human rights law, if you look at labor law, housing rights, environment, disability law. By the way, is there a disabled person here? Is there a single disabled person? Interesting, no? There'll be approximately, what, 70 people? And the extent of disability is, say, 10%, so there would be, in due course, say, 7 disabled persons in the room. And hearing impaired would be, say, 2%. So there would be at least 1 deaf person in the room. 1 deaf, 2 blind, and 3 or 4 orthopedically disabled. In a, if you were represented, right? If it was truly a fair society and disabled persons had a chance. And if I go to Europe and lecture, I can't lecture without a sign language interpreter. Can you imagine? You can't have a lecture without a sign language interpreter standing by your side. They won't allow it. It's against the university policy. But today we don't even have a single room. Anyway, so these are the various branches of law. It's a huge area of law. And it's a huge area of law where you can practice very profitably. Profitably in the sense that with great satisfaction. And it's an area of law where you can practice and earn a decent living. Some parents may tell you, you know, how will you earn your money if you're doing human rights law? But you can. You can charge reasonably. You can have a lot of clients. And you can live a pretty decent financial life. Unless, of course, you want to buy a Mercedes-Benz or a BMW or a penthouse apartment, which you can never get, I can tell you right away. So you can never get that in human rights, but you can lead a pretty decent life and an honorable life, and like you said, with a great deal of satisfaction at the end of the day. So now let's look at some of the issues coming up before the court. Yeah? Was it right? Is it not right? Let's put it that way. Is it not right for India, being predominantly a Hindu country? And as people say, it is predominantly a vegetarian country. People say. Is it not right for the state to say, listen, we want you to listen to and, you know, respect the feelings of the majority of Indians and stop eating beef? Is it not reasonable? Anyone thinks it's reasonable? Anyone thinks it's... Yeah. Go ahead. It's reasonable. How many agree that it's reasonable to say, listen, you respect the feelings of the majority and stop eating beef? How many feel it's not reasonable? And why? What's the argument?
If I don't want to eat it, I will personally not eat it. But how could there? Why would the government tell me to not have it?
My choice.
My personal opinion, rather than someone enforcing their opinion on me, I would rather have that as my personal opinion and not have it.
Correct. So basically, you're saying that the state has no business interfering with these basic personal choices of a person. Probably it's also linked to the right to privacy, the right to dignity, and so on. That is for you to decide what you want to eat and not eat. It's a controversial issue. But what about all these persons who've been lynched and flogged and killed? What about that? Now let's suppose, you know, let's suppose you're right in saying can't eat beef. But what about the flogging and the killing and so on? Would that be justified if somebody did go ahead and... So you would not go to the extent of saying that it's justified to take the law into your own hands and hound somebody, right? Then what would you say about these sadhavis? Then what sadhavi in Goa made a very provocative statement. And she said, anyone who eats beef should be hanged. What would you do as a human rights lawyer? Now think, constitution, think criminal law. What would you do? Faced with a situation where a person makes a statement, what would you do? Anybody? Okay, pause a while. Now listen carefully. You have a right to freedom of speech and expression.
Also,
can I answer? Wait. Yeah, you answer, but let me then sharpen it a little bit. You have a right to freedom of speech and expression. You have a right to the extent that I can offend somebody. Correct? Therefore, you jump. There's a big jump here. I have a right to say on television, let's say whatever, that persons who eat beef should be killed. That's a different proposition from offend. I can offend you. Like I say, you are anti, you know, you're doing something wrong, you're really disrespecting Hindu religion. I can say all that, right? It may offend the person eating, but to say that should be hanged. How would you answer?
So, what I would say is the person making the statement, he himself has a right to express, but when he makes that statement, it is regarding an entire, what you can say, a plethora of people and not a single person. So when you take into consideration right of expression and speech, you should take into consideration the right of speech of many as compared to one.
That's one way. But tell me something, is speech absolute?
Exactly.
Let's say, that's it. I must say, I think this class is one of the best classes I've been to in a long time. Really, because I go to the international law unit, I must tell you, I really cry when I go to the you know? It's really, it's horrifying, you know. And all superficial elegance, superficial, you know, smartness. Because they know the words, they know the lingo, they know the language, they know the phrases. They know when to say what is correct politically. All that kind of, but no feeling really. So you're right. So tell me, articulating that in constitutional law terms, freedom of speech and expression, 19(1)(a) is absolute?
No.
Subject to?
Reasonable
restriction. What is the reasonable restriction in speech? Where would you find it? No, I understand that. You find it in the IPC. Right? 295, I think, whatever. That you can't say things. You can't say things which offend, and you know, and certainly, I mean, just look at the IPC. Can you instigate a crime? Can you advise people to engage in crime? Can you incite? It's an incitement of an offense, no? That please go and kill somebody and so on. Now, let's say as a human rights lawyer, what would you do if you saw it on television? What can you do? The buck, huh? Boss, in human rights work, you never look to your left, you don't look to your right, you don't look behind you, who's with you? If you do that, then it's not a human rights instinct. Is anybody with me? Is anybody supporting me? Will I be all alone? Will I be isolated? The human rights instinct is to react irrespective of support. Now tell me, how would you say you come somewhere, crime will be committed, and it's a national TV program, you know. So what, does everybody think you can't do anything?
Basically, you can bring action against the police, so it should be a police in action for not bringing a case against the society. That could be one way.
So proceed against the police and try and get the police to do their duty by registering an FIR, let's say. That would take longer, correct? Because you know, which policeman today is going to file an FIR against the...
Maybe you could go into social media and start counter...
No, legal. Legal remedy. And bring what? You get the tape recording, right? You go to the magistrate and file a private complaint. Yes, that this is what I saw, this is what has happened. Right? So always in your understanding, in your discussion of human rights law, it ought never to be academic alone. It ought to have a good academic content, but it should not be academic alone. That is to say, okay guys, we figured out this is the breach of section 295, it's hate speech, it's a criminal offense, etc. Let's come to the next topic. No. What are you going to do about it? Because idle chatter is no point, really. So the thing is, we can do this. Maybe you may not do this today, tomorrow, day after, but you must always link the discourse of human rights with a plan of action. Otherwise, we're just armchair, you know, armchair human rights people. Anyone filed a PL in this class? What year is this? What year? All mixed up. Anyone done a PIL? Why? No PIL? Can you imagine if you stand before the Bombay High Court and say, I'm a student of the Government Law College, third year? You introduce yourself. You write it in your petition. And your lordship, I saw, I went to this slum and the policemen were brutally breaking the slum and they broke a school of the children in the slum. As it is, they don't get education and on top of it, they go and break it. And you introduce yourself as a third year Government Law College student. What kind of reaction do you think you'll get? Better than a lawyer, a good lawyer, or worse than a good lawyer? Better? So many judges have their sons and daughters in law college and all that. But apart from that, here they have, which is unusual, they have a student coming forward boldly and nicely saying that this is the situation, this is what they saw. And it could be on anything. A beggar arrested and put behind bars. You know, you have an anti-begging act in the city. Because you're poor, that's a crime and you can be put in. We challenged that before the Delhi High Court now. The cautious statute which says begging is a crime. Having no visible means of subsistence is a crime. Is that act constitutional? Is that act constitutional? Why? You are getting a little bit into cliche. Why? Is an act which says you can pick up a beggar and put that beggar behind bars?
It's like saying you have lesser motive because you have
no money. Correct. Lovely answer. Lovely answer. Better than the answers we gave before, actually. And can you imagine Gautam Buddha would have been put behind bars, no? If he got reincarnated and he came here with his begging bowl and teaching spiritualism, he'd be arrested. The Indian law allows you to arrest. And all our sages and all our holy men, you know, all of them would be behind bars because they...
That's why they're rich.
That's why who's rich? I didn't get that exactly. But anyway. Okay, so we go on from the beef bat now. Love jihad. How many of you feel that that girl should be reconciled with, I mean, should be allowed to see her husband? How many of you feel, that's first. How many of you feel that, oh, this guy is a jihadi character and he's been indoctrinated and she's been indoctrinated by him? How many of you feel that? That's the main argument, right? Indoctrination is the main argument. Normally, an adult woman saying, I want to go back to my husband, you go back to your husband. What is the main argument that even the Supreme Court thought was worthy of consideration? And I'm really disappointed, upset, really disappointed with the way in which the Supreme Court dealt with that matter. You've been indoctrinated, says the state. Government counsel says she's been indoctrinated. Therefore, now we have to send her for psychological analysis, mind waves, brain waves, all that, to check before we send her back and she exercised. But she spoke very clearly. This is my husband. I was a Hindu. I became a Muslim. This is my husband. I love him. I want him to be with me. I want to be with him. But no, you're indoctrinated, says the Supreme Court. And you're just a third year Government Law College student. How dare you contradict the wisdom of the Supreme Court? You know what I mean? So what would you say? Should she be checked first? Let her be checked. Let her brain be mad before she goes back to this terrorist. What do you say? Come on. How many support her not being sent back immediately? Maybe in the future she'll be sent, but today she shouldn't be sent. Till the indoctrination angle is investigated by the main investigation agency for terrorism, the NIA.
Most of the time these are botched up matters which are made by extremist people.
Okay. Okay. But should she be sent back now? Suppose you were a judge sitting. Send her back now. When she's probably indoctrinated terribly with this.
But if she's herself saying that she's not been indoctrinated though, why should I?
Judge is probably hearing her for the second time. Know anything apart from what she's saying? And why will you not have reason to believe what she's saying?
Correct.
Why would she willingly?
You stick to the practice of law, okay? And become a judge or become a lawyer. You can do wonderful things in the world. I want to tell you, I'm so happy with the response. You can do things in India that you can't do abroad. So if any of you are thinking of going to America, or to the UK, or to Europe, to get your LLMs, which I suspect is at the back of your minds. And your parents must be saying, okay, if you want to do this human rights law, you please go and get your LLM first. Because they know by then, you know, you probably wander, your minds will wander into something else. And when I was a young lawyer doing my labor law here in our office in Bombay, this foundation, Rockefeller Foundation, came to me and said, listen, I must have been in my second, third year, fourth year, but I had a lot of labor clients. Because I had worked with Dr. Samath and I had a lot of labor clients. And they said, we'll take you to America for a year or something. And we'll take you to all the campuses and you can see, and you can do this and you can do that. And I looked at all my cases and said, if I come back after a year, all my cases will be virtually with some other lawyer and so on. And I said, no, thank you, sir. I think I'll stick around and do my labor law cases. It seems like a very alluring thing to get your LLM degree and so on. You can never get the education. You can never get the preeminence, world preeminence, that you can get in law as you can get with the practice of law in India. And a lot of young people with very good intentions go abroad too early. And then they go to SOAS, and we have a guy from our Delhi office who's gone to SOAS, and somebody's not here. And they go there, they get totally disoriented and come back. Why do they get disoriented? Because the world doesn't have public interest education. The world, the Western world doesn't even have, you know, proper functioning constitutions, but they got it pretty late. The UK got it virtually with the Human Rights Act. So the kind of aggressive work that you can do in India, in your high courts and Supreme Court, you can't do anywhere in the world. We do, for example, in Delhi, we do 5 or 6 cases in the Supreme Court in a day. In the United States or Europe or let's say Canada, a lawyer who's you know, reputed to be a very good Supreme Court lawyer has probably done 10 cases in his life, 15 cases in his life. We do 10 cases a day, 7 cases a day. Yeah. So you have to go abroad?
No, I'm just saying when you go to a different place, it could be abroad, it could be a different part of Maharashtra maybe. It sharpens your ability to maybe...
Okay, let me put it this way, because public interest litigation is a tool available in India. It's a revolutionary tool. You know most about it. Have you studied anything about it? Have you studied public interest litigation at all? Okay, so who will tell me? What are the distinguishing, what are the revolutionary innovations of public interest litigation? Give me one by one.
The locus standi.
Locus standi. Bang on. You go to America, can you do it? Can you do even class action petitions? That Erin Brockovich, right, she did a class action case, you know, took her years just to get the suit certified as a class action suit. Here you can take pollution in the Ganga and go to the Supreme Court tomorrow. standing, anybody can find. As long as it's a good cause, anybody can find. What else? Correct. It doesn't need to be in writing. It can, you know, you're right. It could be a telegram. I remember we did the Iranian case, the deportation of Iranians, long back when I was in the Bombay High Court, and the Iranian person was being sent back because the Shah of Iran had been deposed, and the Ayatollah Khomeini had come to power. Ayatollah Khomeini had close relationships with the Indian government, so he told the Indian government all these radical Iranians who are, you know, speaking against the Shah and speaking against, you know, torture in Iran, send them back. So now young couples would come to our office, and young couples would be caught by the police, midnight, taken to the airport, sent back. No notice and so on. So I remember calling up Justice Lenton as a young lawyer, and it was about 9 o'clock at night. And I said, "Sir, I'm Colin Gonsalves. Sir, I practice in the High Court sometimes. I've appeared before you." And I was quite scared. You know? And he was a pompous, good judge, but pompous. "Yes." I said, "Sir, there's a matter, sir. An Iranian student is being deported, sir, and we need to get a stay." "So, file a case." I said, "No, sir. He's at the airport and he's locked himself in the toilet and the police are going to arrest him." "Young man, do you know what you're doing? Do you know what time it is?" All that drama went on for 4 or 5 minutes. And my heart was going top, 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 top. And I kept on and I said, "Sir, you must tell the manager. You must give him an oral writ now. Give him an order now telling him not to deport. And then file a case first thing in the morning." And he was so angry. And he went on like this for about 5 minutes, 7 minutes on the phone. Then something changed in him. He was a lovely judge. He was a bit, you know, like, I said pompous, but maybe the right word is formal, you know, very like
British.
Yeah. And then he said, "All right, give the phone to their manager." So then I gave the phone to the manager. And then they told the manager, "Listen, don't deport him. Have him produced in my office tomorrow morning." And then he said, "Give the phone back to that young man." So he did. "Mr. Gonsalves, you are never to repeat this again." So I was all right with that, you know. And then he granted stay and so on. So epistolary, you're talking about postcards. Nobody looks at it today. The courts have turned, many of the courts have turned anti-PIL and so on. So it's a magnificent way where there's a disregard for procedure, protocol and so on, right? What else? Locus standi, informal procedure. What else about public interest litigation?
The limitations that do not apply absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
We got Justice Kuldeep Singh in his element for the environmental matters, where he actually suggested a certain set of procedures which we could adopt.
Very well said.
Who actively following up his own decisions.
And he brought into, see, article, our constitution doesn't have environmental law, right? It doesn't have it as a fundamental right. But he brought it in as a fundamental right. And the three principles of environmental law that he made part of constitutional law were
precautionary
principle,
polluter-based
principle, intergenerational equity, and there are one or two more. This even I forgot. Absolute liability, strict liability, correct? Very well. This is a fantastic class, let me tell you. Correct, so he brought it in, right? It's not there in our constitution, but by judicial lawmaking. But what else are the elements of public interest litigation? Can I say, let me give you a hint.
You need not to follow, in normal litigation, you have to follow the procedure, you have to exhaust your other rights which you have. But in public interdisciplinary litigation, you can approach Supreme Court directly if there is an urgent need.
Very well said. There's no exhaustion of remedies. Very well said. I'll give you another aspect. I'll give you a hint also. Ratlam Municipality. Tell me. Ratlam Municipality.
right to.
Can the government say, for example, in the public interest case, constitutional law case, oh, very good, sir, this is a very important one. Correct. A broad cardinal principle, no court will make an order having huge financial liabilities. It's the business of government to decide budgets, and the courts can't impose additional financial responsibilities on them. How do we answer it? We answer it simply. If you're not implementing human rights, how will you implement human rights if you don't have budgets? Therefore, implementation of human rights and appropriate budgets go hand in hand. Therefore, if somebody says in the Ratlam municipality case they didn't want to clean up an area infested with mosquitoes, you don't have a budget. And what did Krishna Iyer say? You're elected to run your municipality. You resign if you want to go. As long as you're there, you have to. The enforcement of human rights will be the first charge on the exchequer of the state. What does it mean? Pay for human rights first, education, health, food, etc. And after that, you buy your air conditioners for your office, you buy your grand cars for your secretaries and all your chief ministers and so on, etc., etc., etc. What else? Is there anything else? On PIS, the distinguishing features. Good, all right. Yeah. PIS is actually a judicially active, judicially activist kind of theoretical framework. Correct. What else?
My point is about against torture. India has signed the United Nations Convention against torture in 1997, but government haven't yet created any law against torture.
Yeah.
Why won't be so resistant?
We'll come to that. Just remember, keep it in your mind, we'll come to that. But we were looking at the anything more on what's so special about India?
Does it allow the judiciary to, in a way, construe the constitution so as to fulfill what India adopted?
Correct. So that's the idea, right?
Innovation even within constitution. So
of course.
Very dynamic.
Of course. And what's the phrase used for the constitution when you interpret it in a contemporary way and you bring it up to date? What's the phrase used?
Living
constitution. The doctrine of the living constitution. Therefore, when you interpret the constitution, you don't interpret it according to how our founder fathers envisaged the rights working out. It's not as then, it is as it is today. In the evolved circumstances and the changed nation aspirations of young people, you interpret the constitution as. Anyway, you've got the basic thing. The whole of the West is adversarial. The whole of the West is private rights and the redressal of private rights. We finished 10:30 already, isn't it? Yeah, we'll go until about 11 and then we'll try. Right? Private rights. It's in India that the whole world of public interest laws are. You can do cases here that in the West they can't dream of. And when you go, after doing many cases for many years, you become a good public interest lawyer, and you've got judgment on health rights, on women, on the right to food, on disability, and you go abroad and talk about the cases you've done, the professors at Harvard and Yale and New York University and Oxford, the professors will be totally taken aback. Why? Because the Western world doesn't generate this volume and this quality of human rights law. Can you imagine a court delivering a transgender judgment like our Supreme Court has? How many of you have read the transgender judgment? Hey, that is what's going on here. That's a rather Christian judgment. What year was that, Kapil?
2014.
And what's the title of that case?
Nalsa case.
Can you imagine judicial activism which brings the transgender community within the ambit of constitutional protection? I mean, it's judicial activism of a very fine and refined sort in India. So anyway, what I'm trying to say is that public interest litigation and human rights law generally gives you opportunities to get wonderful judgments. We get judgment after judgment from the Supreme Court. Our colleagues in Bombay get case after case, and they get wonderful judgments from the high courts. And we generate about, in a year, I would say, we generate about 50, maybe 50 important judgments. And maybe 100 plus smaller orders, but we generate 50 important judgments. The right to food case, which brought food to 700 million people, was a case the Human Rights Law Network did, started in 2000 and is running till today. The AFSPA case, does anybody remember the Manipur killing case? You remember it? Tell me, what's it about?
The security forces used AFSPA and they were signing...
What was the Supreme Court judgment?
Supreme Court case to revoke it.
Not revoke it, no. Supreme Court judgment said that whether you're wearing a uniform or not, it makes little difference. If you're killing a person in cold blood, you will be treated as a common criminal and punished in a criminal court. Very important judgment. The West Bengal Tata, what was that? Singhu case. Read it, anybody? Tell me.
Kedarnath
Yadav. Oh, I love this class. Particularly when you remember that I was there. Kedarnath's case. Such a simple case. Right? The Land Acquisition Act has two parts. You give us the main ratio of the judgment? Kedarnath? How did it get? No. Anybody knows? Tell me, if you remember, tell me.
No.
What is the ratio of the case? The ratio. You're right. The West Bengal government gave the land to Tatas, no? Tatas came by helicopter. They looked all over the place and they said, "Yeh zameen achhi hai. I want this." And they took it like that. They took it. But what is the ratio of the case? It's a very important ratio in land acquisition, land rights. The Land Acquisition Act has two parts. The first part relates to public purpose. That is to say, the government is acquiring land for a public purpose, hospitals, schools, you know, etc., etc. The second part, chapter 7.
Both of them differ, but agreed on the same point. One agreed that this is not for public purpose, and the other said that technically they had not done land acquisition in a proper way.
So I'm referring to Justice Gopal Gowda's part of that judgment. The end result was the same. They gave the land back. They took the land away from the Tatas, they gave the land back. But the important thing, the point I'm driving home is, chapter 7 is the part relating to acquisition for companies. And there is a totally different route. Acquisition for public purpose, generally you've had it. The government tries to get your land, they get your land. But acquisition for private companies is very different. You have to sit with the farmers and get them to agree. You have to sit with the farmers and work out the price that land will be taken. You have to establish that this is not prime agricultural land. Because if it's prime agricultural land, you can't take that for corporations. And you have to establish that there is no other land available in the vicinity, which is barren land and so on, which can be used for acquisition. And Justice Gopal Gowda's judgment is a wonderful judgment. Setting aside the acquisition, ultimately both the judges agreed on the end result and they gave the land back to the people in Singapore.
So I guess similar case is going on in Supreme Court now in Gurong, representing the case from Shahpur
in Haridwar
district,
the
land acquisition for Tatas only.
Oh,
recently
the
Supreme Court came at the ground level and recorded all the...
The judges came there and recorded it.
Some of
the judges... You're from that village?
Yeah,
so you come work with us?
Yes. And Supreme Court recorded each and every single person's evidence that either you are with the petitioner or not at my place.
I think she's
Yeah.
She's a Ranjan doctor.
So that we don't have much time, maybe 15 minutes to sort of try and draw some general conclusions. We need a lot more time actually for a session like this, which can be a combination of interaction as well as a kind of a lecture. The lecture part went for a bit of six today, but anyway, it was a very good interaction. So basically, as a small law firm, right, as an NGO kind of a law firm, you'd be amazed at the kind of results we've got over many years, many years, not only in the Supreme Court, but also in various high courts. And we have roughly about 22 offices where young lawyers like you do all kinds of very interesting and pioneering work in the various high courts. If you do this kind of work again and again and again and again, and you refine your skills, not just public interest work, a big part of human rights work is criminal law. How many of you are going into prisons? Are going into prisons? You visit prisons and you meet the prisoners and so on as part of legal aid work?
As a part of the prison reform committee.
In Bombay?
Very
good. Justice Radhakrishnan?
Yes.
There's a committee there.
Justice Radhakrishnan was a very fine judge in the High Court. Very fine judge in the High Court. I must tell you, give you a little insight. You saw the fire in Kamala Mills, right? Now, Justice Radhakrishnan actually gave an order saying that when the mills are being destroyed and development work will take place, right, you must keep 1/3 of the land for green parks and so on, 1/3 of the land for housing for workers, and 1/3 could be used for commercial purposes. Brilliant judgment. It's called the Bombay Dyeing case. If you go to the Bombay High Court site, Bombay Dyeing must have been in the 90s somewhere, but a very important case. And he gave a wonderful judgment. Came to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court gave a terrible, terrible judgment, reversing all that, so that 1/3 that went for open spaces got finished off, 1/3 which went to workers' housing got finished off, and all these companies in the textile mills grabbed the land, the entire land. Now, had Justice Radhakrishnan's order been implemented, gardens for children, for old people, and so on, and of course housing for the poor, but the Supreme Court made a terrible, terrible order. I was in that case, actually, the Supreme Court. We were very upset when judgment was delivered. And the fate of India, the fate of Bombay got sealed. Can you imagine? Can you just imagine what it would have been like if Justice Radhakrishnan's order was upheld? Open spaces and public housing. And instead you have what you have today in the textile area. And the Kamala Mill fire takes place because everything is closed in. The fire brigade, things can't get in because there's no space for them to get in. And it has its roots in the way in which development took place after the textile industry was closed.
So, what was the mission that Supreme Court gave
for this? Yeah, I'll give you the answer later because it will take away too much time at this stage. But I just want to end the talk today by saying that, you know, in public interest law, gives you the opportunities, not just for India, gives you opportunities worldwide. Our young lawyers who do cases, for example, we had a young lawyer with us in Delhi, who's done a series of abortion cases. You might have read in the papers, 10 of the leading abortion cases, where women who had fetuses with fetal deformities, it's not allowed in the law, but permitted by the Supreme Court to undergo abortions. You can go to the abortion cases. Supreme Court said go to the abortion cases. And the person in our office, her name is Sneha. So you can ask her about the cases and so on. So when a person like that, she's maybe fourth year in practice of law, fifth year practice of law, when she went and attended a conference in Ireland and she went to some other countries and spoke about abortion rights, it really blew their minds. How come your Indian judiciary is so active? How come? I mean, our courts are so reluctant and so slow to take up these issues. And the professors of law are so amazed by what they hear. And the story that the kind of result that I'm trying to get from all this is, if you work and you practice as a lawyer in India and you work for the poor and you get judgment after judgment after judgment, as you are sure to do, even in terms of studying law further, you go for your LLM or you go for your PhD, you're much better equipped because you have practiced, you have understood in constitutional law, and you practiced it in the country, and you've got victories that you cannot never get anywhere in the world. And Indian law is so superior that this is really the best area for you to work. And so I feel very sad when people, young people from here go and say after they do their LLB, I'm going to do their, my LLM, because I know we've lost the litigating lawyer. You do your LLM, you look at the, you look at London, you get totally disoriented, you know, by Western science of living and so on. And then you'll come back and probably apply to the college to teach. You won't, you'll get out of litigation. Because litigation requires a lot of hard work. Litigation requires a lot of struggle in the formative years as a lawyer. And so now before I go, how many of you will still want to practice as a litigator after you get your degree? It's a very satisfying life. It's a very, very satisfying life. And one more thing, clients. You'll get more clients than you ever could imagine. Because who does cases for the poor? There are people who are doing cases for companies and rich capitalists. But who does cases for the poor? 80% of the Indian population. So you start your career in family law, labor law, housing rights, environmental law, disability rights, tribal rights, Dalit rights, HIV and the law. What am I missing? Minority rights. You start your practice and people say this is a dedicated person. She works hard, she comes early morning to her office, she leaves in the evening, she talks to her clients politely, she prepares nicely, she argues nicely. You win one case, it spreads like wildfire. Because there are no lawyers for the poor in this country. You go to a lawyer, they'll say, put 10,000 on my table. You go to Delhi, they'll say, put 5 lakhs on my table before I open your papers. Can you imagine? And so when your reputation spreads as a woman lawyer, as a disability rights lawyer, as a criminal lawyer, that you can get people out on bail and so on, when your reputation spreads, you get client after client. And the key to success is that you work with every person honorably, deal with them with integrity, charge them reasonable amounts. If a person is very poor, then you can do it free, that's not a problem. But generally, you charge them reasonable amounts. And by doing a large volume of work all your life, you will lead a pretty alright life. No lawyer starves. No lawyer suffers financial hardship, really. And you can live a pretty peaceful and satisfied life. Like you said, at the end of the day, you get peace of mind. So on that positive note, we'll end now because I'm going off actually to this to give a little talk there. I'm happy to have come here. I'm really very happy to have come here. And if in Government Law College, you know, you and your fellow students want to organize something, you know, like organize a one-day festival of human rights, you know, maybe we could do that. Human rights films, human rights lectures, poetry, music, you know. And if you want to also engage with us on doing cases on human rights, you want to work with some of our cases, we're doing a large number of our cases. And our office is just here, near the Stock Exchange. So it's very close by. You're welcome to come, you're welcome to intern with us and learn. And we'd like to have you do public interest cases. Put your name onto certain cases and come to the High Court and argue. And I guarantee you, you do a nice case, prepare it properly, you'll have quite a bit of success. And that will be a first, I think, for Government Law College to have its students win cases in the High Court. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.